Some people have speculated that the wave, the increase in transgenderism, gender dysphoria, is due to rapid onset gender dysphoria. But it could be due to gender-bending chemicals in bottled water, and other drinking water. In 2018, we saw this story from the New York Post. Teen hormones being altered by gender-bending chemicals. Now, I pulled up this old story because it's important context to a news story. It turns out, humans are being exposed to 44 times more infertility-causing, cancer-linked, gender-bending chemicals than first thought. Could it be that young men and women in our countries, in the West, in the world, are being exposed to chemicals that leach from bottled water and otherwise, disrupting their hormones and then making them gender dysphoric? That may be the case. So I'll read a little bit of this first story so you understand what these chemicals are and what they do. I think they're BPAs. And then I'll read about how our exposure to them exceed the FDA's safe levels by as much as 44-fold. I will also mention, I don't drink tap water. I drink filtered water. 4 out of every 5 British teens have their hormones upset by gender-bending chemicals found in plastics, new research suggests. The chemical, called bisphenol A, BPA, is used to make plastics, including materials that come into contact with food. Excuse me. But it can mimic the female hormone estrogen and cause a lower sperm count in men. The chemical is also thought to be linked to several different types of cancer, including breast and prostate. Researchers at Exeter University studied the blood and urine of 94 teenagers aged 17 to 19 and found 80% had hormone-disrupting chemicals in their bodies. Ecotoxicology professor Tamara Galloway, who co-led the study, said there was growing evidence that exposure to the chemical may be associated with poorer health. Professor Lorna Harries, who also worked on the study, described it as a pervasive disruptor and added, "We should have a choice over what we put in our bodies." When the teens changed their diet to include more fresh produce, the BPA levels among those with the highest levels began to fall, and there was little change among others. BPA is legal in the UK. In the United States, things are more complicated. The FDA said in 2012 that baby bottles and child sippy cups could not contain BPA, as it is banned in a number of states. However, it is still legal in products intended for adults in many states. And that means when you buy bottled water, when you buy prepackaged foods, if you're eating all of this stuff, you are getting inundated with these chemicals. I'd be interested to see if they ran tests on gender dysphoric youth, if they found an increase in BPAs. That would be interesting. They say, I think you get the context about what this is. The Food Standard Agency website says, minute amounts of BPA can transfer from packaging into food and drinks, but independent experts have advised that these levels of exposure are not considered to be harmful. Independent studies have shown that even when consumed at high levels, BPA is rapidly absorbed, detoxified, and eliminated from humans. Campaigners have called for it to be banned from all products across the continent. Okay, but what happens when you're exposed to 44 times more of this chemical than they actually thought? They say, the FDA says the levels in widely used products are generally safe. However, the agency banned the use of these chemicals in baby bottles and sippy cups in 2012. Now, Washington State University research devised a new direct way of testing human exposure to the chemicals. They found they exceed the FDA's safe levels by as much as 44 times. Humans are exposed to far more hormone-disrupting chemicals than previously thought, according to a new study. Patricia Hunt, the researcher at Washington State University who first discovered that BPA, a dangerous toxin in plastics, can cause cancer and other diseases and disorders, has now developed a more accurate method of measuring it. In a study published today, Dr. Hunt reveals the new tool shows the safe limit of BPA stipulated by the food is 40, so we know that's 44 times higher. This study raises serious concerns about whether we've been careful enough about the safety of this chemical. What it comes down to is that the conclusions federal agencies have come to about how to regulate BPA may have been based on inaccurate measurements. The amount of BPA the FDA considers acceptable varies based on the product. Broadly, it claims that the chemicals are safe and that people are exposed to such low doses of them that they're not toxic. However, they did ban CB cups, we know that. Methodology used by the FDA to establish what is or isn't safe has been subject to scrutiny from a number of scientists. Dr. Hunt has led that charge. She discovered the way the BPA, sometimes referred to as gender-bending chemicals, interfere with the production of sperm, eggs, and male and female chromosomes. Dr. Hunt has long acknowledged that measuring humans' exposure to BPAs is difficult, but argues that that is all the more reason to err on the side of caution. In her latest work, she developed a new way to test just how much BPA people are exposed to. According to Dr. Hunt and her colleagues, most studies attempting to measure the amount of BPA in human urine have done so by putting BPA metabolites, compounds generated as the chemicals pass through the body, into a snail-based enzyme solution that is supposed to turn the compounds back to BPA itself. This is an indirect measure, according to the study published in the journal, The Lancet Diabetes and Endocrinology. Instead, she and her team devised a way to assess the metabolites themselves directly. What they found was alarming. Not only was the disparity between the indirect measure and the direct on as wide as 44-fold, the higher the level of BPA, the greater the gulf between their measure and the one used by the FDA. Quote, I hope this study will bring attention to their methodology used to measure BPA, and that other experts and labs will take a closer look and closer look at and assess independently what is happening, said the study's first author, Roy Garona. So recently, there has been an explosion in transgender youth and individuals. There's been an argument about why that is. I don't know if it even makes sense that BPAs could cause this, but they say in the other article from the New York Post that they mimic estrogen. Let me just come back to this before I move on. They can mimic the hormone estrogen and lower sperm counts in men. There was another study the Daily Mail was published. I don't have it pulled up. That said that the Y chromosome is vanishing in older men. Could it be that this increase, the loss of the Y chromosome, the increase in transgender youth and individuals is due to BPAs? I'm just asking because I don't really know. Perhaps someone who's more scientifically inclined could come and explain to me, explain why that may or may not be the case. But I'd imagine if it could mimic estrogen, that would be the case, right? There's a trope about the soy boy because of phytoestrogens. But let me just tell you something. It's possible this could have an inverse effect. People look at the soy thing and they say soy boys are weak and effeminate. But hold on. Phytoestrogen found in soy is actually not as potent, my understanding, as your actual female estrogen. In which case, if phytoestrogen is blocking the receptor, you're actually getting a weaker version of estrogen, so it should have the opposite effect, right? I don't know. Don't look at me. I'm not a scientist. But I will say, some have argued, the reason we are seeing an increase in trans youth is because it's becoming acceptable. That the more people say you're free to be trans, no one will judge you, we'll support you in the press, that more people are willing to tell the truth about how they really feel. And I can respect that. That's probably true to a certain degree. It's also possible, however, there's an inverse effect here. That as more and more people are inundated by these chemicals, there is a bigger demand for acceptance. See, if there were no trans people, there would be no call for accepting trans people because they wouldn't exist, but they do exist. Is it possible that our chemicals and plastics and everything and these hormones, and I also heard stories about how like women's birth control hormones go in the water too. Is it possible that is feminizing men and resulting in them now feeling this way and then demanding acceptance? It's hard to know for sure because correlation is not causation. But I will add, the BPA thing doesn't explain trans men. And according to the articles and the science articles I've talked about in the past, almost all, like 85% of trans youth are female to male, not the other way around. For some reason, we almost always hear about male to female. It's probably due to male pubertal advantages. You know, it's going to be someone who was born male and then at 17 or 18 transitioned and now they have an advantage. So those make the press. But according to the studies on rapid onset gender dysphoria, the majority of trans youth are actually born female and want to become male. That wouldn't, so BPAs would not explain that. What they try to argue that is societal pressures and other women encouraging them. It could be that as BPAs feminize men who then demand, you know, acceptance, it creates a trend which then results in young females saying, hey, I should do this as well. I don't know. It could just be that sometimes people are trans. And I don't think the reason really matters for the most part. I think it matters to a certain degree, but when it comes to civil rights, it doesn't. If we want to figure out how to support and protect people, then a conversation needs to be had in good faith where we talk about how to do that. Unfortunately, a lot of activists have been trying to shut these things down. It's made it really, really difficult to pass laws that make sense. And in fact, the laws that end up getting passed could be disruptive and actually take civil rights away, which is really, really complicated. And I don't want to rehash all that stuff. So I'll just leave by saying, when we talk about the science behind what's causing this, this could be one of those reasons. So you might not care about plastics, you know, and the toxic, but I'll tell you what, man, glass bottles, fresh food. I try to eat as good as possible, and you should too. I'll leave it there, and I will wrap up by saying, in lieu of not working, because I just got a root canal. If you guys haven't been following all my content, you know, I had a root canal yesterday, and I got two temporary crowns put in. It's very difficult to talk. It hurts, but I refuse to take a day off. So I apologize if these videos weren't typically, you know, up to par as they normally are, and it is hard for me to talk. I thank you all for hanging out and watching today's videos. And I hope I was able to do sufficient work for you in my convalesced state. Is that the right word? Convalescence? Yeah. I mean, I'm okay. I haven't eaten anything in 2 days, but I'll see you tomorrow. And hopefully then I'll be feeling better. Thanks for hanging out.